Hi, I'm Peter Czanik from Hungary, syslog evangelist at Balabit, developers of syslog-ng. I'm doing syslog-ng packaging support and advocacy. Let me give you a quick overview of what I will talk about today. First of all, I will give you a quick introduction to syslog-ng and its major roles and configuration. Then I will talk more in depth about logging containers. I mean, not just containers in, themselves, but also the Docker infrastructure. And if time permits, I will also show you a few interesting possibilities at the end. So, first of all, what is logging? It's a recording of events on a computer, like an SSH login message, which you can see on screen. And syslog-ng is an enhaenced logging daemon with a strong focus on high performance and central log collection. Why central logging is so important? First of all, it's ease of logging. Instead of logging into each of your machine to check your log messages, you have a single location to check your log messages. It's also availability. Even if the sending machine is down, you can still check your log messages and figure out what happened. And it's also security. One of the first things when a computer is hacked is to remove log messages. If you have central logging, you have valuable log messages even if the sender machine is compromised. And it's even more important in a containerized environment, as you start and stop containers around the clock. Some leave only for a few minutes or hours, but you might need your log messages days or even months away for analysis, for example, a breach event. Syslog-ng has four major roles. It collects log messages, it can process them, filter them, and finally store them. The first role is data collection. It can collect system and application logs together, which can provide quite interesting contextual data for either side. It supports a wide variety of platform-specific sources like devlog, journal, sun streams, and so on. As a central log collector, it knows all the different versions of syslog protocol, the legacy, the new version over UDP, TCP, and encrypted connections. And not just that, but can collect any kind of logs or text data from applications through five sockets and even from application output. The next, and in my view, one of the most important feature of syslog-ng is log processing. You can use it to classify, normalize, and structure log messages with built-in parsers. You can even rewrite log messages, and you don't have to think about falsifying messages here, but for example, anonymization, which is required by quite a lot of compliance regulations. You can enrich your log messages using GIP or add fields based on the message content. And if your destination needs a specific format, like JSON or a specific date format for parsing, you can produce that using templates within syslog-ng. Another important role is filtering, which has two main uses. First of all, you can discard surplus log messages, like you don't want to store all of your debug level messages, and it's also message routing, making sure that the right messages reached right destinations, for example, your authentication-related events reach your SIEM system. There are plenty of possibilities. It can be based on message content, different message parameters. You can use comparisons, wildcards, many different filtering functions. And best of all, any of these can be combined using Boolean operators. Finally, you have to store your log messages somewhere. Traditionally, log messages were saved locally in flat files or sent using the syslog protocol to a central syslog server and stored there into flat files. Later, SQL databases were added as destinations. The past few years, we added Hadoop, MongoDB, Elasticsearch, and Kafka as big data destinations. But if you look to Splunk, HTTP destination can come handy, and if none of these fit your needs, you can extend syslog-ng in Java or Python next to C. Before jumping to containers, I want to give you a quick overview of configuring syslog-ng. My initial advice is don't panic. The syslog-ng configuration looks quite difficult at first, but if you take a moment to look at it, you will see that it's quite easy. It's and logical. It has building blocks which you connect together at the end using log statements. Here I will walk you through a short syslog-ng configuration. It always starts with a version number. When I was doing it was 3.12. You can include external files to this configuration. The example here is scl.conf. It stands for syslog-ng configuration library, which includes many configuration snippets to use. For example, you can match credit card numbers with a regular expression included there, and there are many others. Of course, you can place comments in your configuration, and in the at the beginning, you can have some global options to make configuration easier. Here, we define a few sources. At the top, you see some local log sources combined into a single source. System stands for platform-specific log sources like devlog or journal or kernel messages. And internal stands for syslog-ng's internal messages, so like opening and closing a network connection and so on. The other one is a network source, in this case a UDP source collecting messages on the default port. Here we can see a few destinations. The first one is simple, it's a usual flat file destination for var log messages. The other one is a bit more complex. It's an Elasticsearch destination where we define an index name, cluster name, and a nice long template what we want to store to Elasticsearch. Here we define a number of filters and parsers. The first filter, no debug, simply discards any debug level messages. The second one combines four different filtering functions with Boolean operators. At the bottom of the screen, I mentioned message parsing. One parser is PatternDB, which can parse unstructured messages like an SSH login, but it needs an XML database to describe these log messages, and here you can see loading this database. And here is the heart of the configuration. where all of these components are wired together. The first one is for var log messages, as you can see, collecting logs from the localhost, using the messages filter and sending it to the thread file. The other one is a bit more complex. Here we use both the network source and the local source, filter out any debug level messages, parse the rest with patterndb, and in the end, storing messages to Elasticsearch. Before going on to containers, I have a tricky question for you. What do you think? Which is the most popular? Which syslog-ng version is the most used? Project started 20 years ago. Slash 12 has version 3.6. The latest stable version is 3.15. Can you guess which is the most used version? Sorry? First one? You are quite close, actually. It's 1.6, about 15 years old. It's running all of the Kindle ebook readers. I guess no other syslog-ng version is running in 100 million copies. So, you were pretty close. So, going to more serious topics, containers. There were many different implementations long before Docker. Personally, I used FreeBSD jails for over a decade with tens of thousands of web servers running on in jails, but there are also Solaris zones and many others. But it was Docker, actually, which made containers popular, as it made using containers a lot more easier. And syslog-ng can work in a containerized environment. You can easily migrate your central logging to a container. You can use syslog-ng to collect all of your infrastructure logs, all of your container logs, and best of all, you can combine any of these roles together in a single syslog-ng instance. There are many different syslog-ng images available. The Belabit syslog-ng image is based on Ubuntu, always has the latest syslog-ng release and all features enabled inside, but there are many other images on Docker Hub. Okay, I know it's an openSUSE event, but I still mention Alpine Linux-based images, as those are extremely small, like just a few megabytes compared to hundreds of megabytes of other images. But you can easily create a syslog-ng image based on openSUSE or SLES as well. Here is an example. This is how I create my own syslog-ng image. I use leap as a starting point. Of course, leap is always a few releases behind the syslog-ng releases, so I have syslog-ng in the build service under my username, and I use this to build Docker images and expose the different standard syslog related ports. The first and the easiest use case is to migrate a central log server into a container. It's pretty close to what you do on a host. often people just use network sources on their central log server and can use any filtered parser or destination supported by the used syslog-ng image. Here is an example command line how to start it. Usually the configuration file and the directory where the logs are stored are mapped from the host machine. Here you can see this nice graph. On the right hand side you can see a Docker host with a syslog-ng container on it, which has a network source collecting log messages over the network, a file destination, and a directory mapped from the host machine where you are saving your log messages. Here is a simple configuration to get you started. It's really very simple, just bare bones, but this is usually what I use for testing. Of course, a version number declaration. Then here I declare a network source for the UDP and TCP sources, a file to store log messages, and finally a log statement which combines the two together. You can use syslog-ng also to collect your Docker infrastructure and container logs, and also to send your logs to a central location using syslog-ng. For this, we recommend using the journal logging driver within Docker, which has the advantage that you can keep using the Docker logs command on your container hosts. And using syslog-ng, you gain a full-featured remote log collection implementation, as in contrast to those which are inside Docker, which are quite simplistic. Using this method, you can collect host and Docker infrastructure logs, and also most part of your container logs. I mean those which are sent by the, to the standard out of the container by the applications. Docker stores name value pairs next to the log messages to indicate which container they are originating from, and syslog-ng can use these name value pairs to filter messages or and also store them, so you can, no data is lost. Starting syslog-ng in this case a bit more tricky. First of all, you need to map the journal directory from the host machine. Other way, you cannot read it. And the other thing is that you need to map the machine ID from the host machine. Other way, you cannot find the log messages inside the journal. Here you can see that this on a graph. Here is a syslog-ng container reading log messages from the host journal and sending destination to a directory map from the host. And here is one more thing. Standard syslog messages don't contain too much extra information. So if you store messages with the default template, all of the additional data from the journal is lost. I mean the container identifiers. So it's better to use some kind of structured logging for this, for example, JSON or key value pairs. Here is a sample configuration for this. The first one is a journal source. The next one is an internal source. This is just for debugging. You can skip it if you want. Below it, you find the destination for the internal messages. But the most interesting part is the next one. This long template here, which means that this is not a simple flat file, but a JSON formatted file where you collect all of the syslog related fields and any name value pairs extracted from the journal. And at the end, of course, you need to connect the sources and destinations using the log statements. You can collect log messages even if from containers, even if your application doesn't log to standard out. This can be achieved by sharing directories or what is it called, volumes between the application containers and the syslog container. You can syslog-ng also supports reading log messages from pipes. So, just like with the files, you can use volumes to share pipes between the application and syslog containers. And in this case, you don't even need to implement log rotation or deleting old logs, making things a lot more easy. On the right-hand side, you see the syslog-ng container with a file source. On the left-hand side, you see a couple of other containers, your application containers, in between the volumes shared between the application and syslog container. And in the end, it's also worth to send log messages to external directory and in a structured format to make sure that you also save where the logs are originating from. I see that I still have plenty of time, so I want to touch a few extra topics, like today is the day of GDPR, so I know everyone hates know this buzzword, but it's a way of life now. And there are many related regulations even for logging in PCI DSS, which I mentioned, credit card numbers. There are very strict regulations that they must not leak. In GDPR, there are many personal data like IP addresses, usernames, and stuff like that are better not to be logged or forbidden to be logged. You can use syslog-ng to locate this sensitive information and to anonymize it. There are multiple ways to locate information. One is using regular expressions. It's quite slow and resource intensive. On the other hand, it also works with unknown log messages. If you use one of the parsers of syslog-ng, like ButtonDB or the CSV parser, they were working blazing fast. On the other hand, you can only use it for known log messages. Anonymizing can be done in multiple ways. Actually, the first one is anonymizing, overwriting the sensitive information with a constant. The other one is called pseudonymization. When you overwrite the original sensitive information with a hash, which means that you don't know the username or the IP address or whatever what is stored in your log message. On the other hand, you can still analyze your logs easily and follow IP addresses or user sessions or whatever in your logs, as the same username is always turned into the same hash. So it facilitates log analysis and makes your log messages a lot more useful than simple anonymization. Here is a nice screenshot from Kibana. The interesting part here is the upper right corner, where you can see a couple of IP addresses parsed from SSH login messages. This screenshot was done with the exact configuration I used to explain syslog-ng configuration basics. And you can see that it's worth the trouble to deal with ParternDB and Elasticsearch, as you can extract quite useful data from your log messages. Here is another Kibana screenshot from a more recent Kibana version. This is a map created from firewall logs. I have a Turisomnia router at home, which is running IP tables and logs all of the IP addresses which are trying to connect from the outside world. And I live in a quiet suburb of Budapest. But as you can see, internet is not really quiet even in a quiet suburb, as this was just a few hours and I've got connection. Probably the only exception is Australia and Antarctica. But the rest of the continents are covered. And here is how you can do that. First of all, you need to send your log messages to somewhere where you have Elasticsearch. But so here is we start here with a TCP source coming from my router. The next one is a key value parser. As IP tables provides log messages, which key value, and so on. So we can parse those easily into name value pairs, and later on we can act on these name value pairs. Here in the GeoIP parser, you can see that we choose the source IP address, and we run the GeoIP parser on it. So syslog-ng adds the longitude, latitude information to the log message as a name value pair. This is not the exact format as Elasticsearch expects data. So in the next rewrite rule, we create GeoIP location in the format as Elasticsearch expects it. And finally, we store the results in Elasticsearch. And if you look at it in Kibana, you see this really nice graph. So, a few words about what's new in recent syslog-ng versions. We added disk space buffering, a new correlation parser, so you can correlate name value pairs from different parsers within syslog-ng. You can write your own parsers in Python. Support for the REST API in Elasticsearch was added. HTTP destination, wildcard firesource. Wildcard firesource means that in the syslog-ng configuration, you don't have to define the exact name of the file, what you are reading, like an HTTP access log, but you can give it a directory and say that let's read all of the HTTP access logs from a directory. If you have many virtual hosts, you don't have to define each of them, but simply use the wildcat file source. And recently we had many performance and memory usage improvements also coming from the community. So what are the main benefits of using syslog-ng? First of all, it's high performance and reliable log collection. It's also a simplified architecture, as a simple application can be used both for syslog and application data. It's a lot more easily to use data, as you can parse messages and present it in a ready to use format. And it's also a lower load on your destinations where you analyze your logs, thanks to efficient message filtering. If you want to join the syslog-ng community or just simply learn more about syslog-ng, our main website is syslog-ng.org. The source code is on GitHub, and you can find also our issue tracking system there. We have we can be reached on a mailing list, and if you want more real-time help, you can also use Jitter. And do you have any questions? What kind of performance inside Docker? Oh, so the question was performance of syslog-ng. It actually depends quite a lot on your hardware and also on your configuration. Syslog-ng scales quite well to multiple CPUs, but not all loads. And of course, message parsing also takes a toll on performance. On most recent hardware, even with message parsing, about 200,000 messages is quite realistic. But of course, if you have a lot of parsers, it can go lower. If you don't have any parsers, just storing plain text messages, then it can go much higher. I measured myself well over 800,000 messages, but that's on a very strong hardware with SSDs and so on. So it's without any parsing. So it really depends on your configuration. But even a simple Raspberry Pi, not even the latest one, I don't have that, but Raspberry Pi 2, I measured about 60,000 messages a second without parsing, and still over 5,000 messages with encryption and message parsing. Did I answer a question? Any other questions? So the question was in what format to store log messages. What many of our users are doing is storing to Elasticsearch. But that also needs quite powerful hardware. Some not so nice expression is that you need your personal nuclear power station to power Elasticsearch, but people are still using it quite a lot. I know many people who use MySQL for storing log messages, but it also archiving, most people use simple flat files or use the JSON format I mentioned. As with JSON, you have the it's larger, but you can store additional information, not just a single syslog message, but for example, if you stored Docker messages, you can store the originating container and other name value pairs with your message, and you can in a log analysis tool you can feed it easily most of the time with JSON based log messages. So it really depends on what how you use it later on. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.